British Leyland, as history remembers it, was first established in January 1968 as the British Leyland Motor Corporation through the merger of two already successful British industrial companies, namely British Motor Holdings and Leyland Motors. The idea of such a merger seemed to make sense to many, as two companies situated in two different automotive markets were to become one large conglomerate that offered both private and commercial vehicles to their British and international customer base. BMH, an already internationally recognised company in its own right, produced cult classics such as the Austin Mini and Morris Minor that both sold in steady and successful numbers throughout their entire lifespan, the Mini especially being produced 5.3 million times between 1959 and 2000. Leyland Motors was led by the eccentric Lord Donald Stokes and specialised in producing large commercial vehicles for many areas of the market from the Second World War onward, although first appearing in 1896 as a steam motor company. Amidst pressures by Prime Minister Harold Wilson and the British government in the late 1960s, BLMC formed largely from an incentive to increase and strengthen the British industry as much as possible, as Harold Wilson naturally saw the sector as an integral piece of the British economy. And rather than have many smaller but still equally as successful independent companies jotted around Britain, the idea of one huge conglomerate seemed more sensical to the government at the time. Although on its last legs from the late 1970s onward, British Leyland went through three iterations during its lifespan, first as the BLMC from 1968 until 75, then upon nationalisation by the government during one of its most tumultuous periods, it was introduced as British Leyland, and finally being reduced to a mere BL in 1978 under the guise of new director Michael Edwards. Like many other motor companies during this time period, British Leyland suffered extensively from economic and political matters that plagued the 60s and 70s. National strikes, the oil crisis, and introductions such as the three-day week were all hard blows to the already struggling British Leyland. But unlike many other competitors, British Leyland's track record of union strikes and the almost non-existent communication between management and workforce did not help towards its image to the British public. With a regularly disgruntled workforce, British Leyland saw more strikes than any other motor company during the 70s, which not only affected their public image, but equally important their production and marketing performances. British Leyland were known for some of the most unreliable and worst built cars to exist in 60s and 70s Britain, amongst thin and weak body shells that would rot within years of being produced, and mechanical components that were not built with quality and longevity in mind. It is amongst these factors and many more to be discussed in this documentary that we shall see how and why British Leyland failed miserably within 20 years of its inception. A principal figure throughout some of British Leyland's worst years was Lord Donald Stokes, the original director who held his position until 1973. Upon stepping down following increasing pressures from many who no longer saw Stokes as fit for the job. Stokes was often the scapegoat of British Leyland due to his position in leading the company throughout its worst years, when in reality, one can argue that a range of staff members all equally contributed to the slow demise of the company. Stokes never considered himself to be the great fixer of Britain's industrial problems throughout the 60s and 70s, stating in a 1988 interview that, "I think I was probably good at selling. I was not, and I have never pretended to be a manufacturing expert ever. I have no pretensions as to that." Stokes' interview undertaken by Jonathan Wood in 1988 recalls, "I wasn't, none of us were, trained to run a company of 190,000 or so people. Many, including Harold Wilson, expected Stokes to undertake the management of some 190,000 employees within the recent 1968 merger, when in reality Stokes had been a hands-on manager of a much smaller commercial vehicle company, and when Stokes inevitably began to fail in successfully managing the masses under the BLMC, it became natural for many to blame him." The overlapping of workers between different companies was not the only concern of BLMC either. With struggles of thousands of blue-collar and white-collar staff members, also came the jumbled mess that was the countless makes and models that were practically identical to each other, apart from the different shell, or often badge stuck on the front grille. To exemplify this, the BMC 1100-1300 series, a very popular but already jumbled mess of badge-engineered models, was one of the former British Motor Corporation's best-selling cars throughout the 60s, Yet, it was released under Austin, Morris, MG, and some of BMC's luxurious names, including Riley, Wolseley, and Van den Plas. Six brands selling exactly the same car. Upon the merger, this and many other badge-engineered modules were absorbed into BLMC's new combined product range, which created even more confusion amongst the general customer base, as British Leyland's BMC 1300 series was up against one of its biggest like-for-like competitor, the Triumph 1300, which was also owned and sold by the BLMC. Humorously, it is confusing enough to discuss some of these overlapping models in a documentary, meaning one can only imagine the stress and confusion these problems caused to the management of British Leyland. If an abundance of closer related cars competing against each other under one company wasn't enough to begin tarnishing the reputation of British Leyland, Stokes was also shocked to find the utter lack of development into new models when reviewing the BMH side of the new merger. The Austin Mini had not been updated in almost 10 years, and many of BMC's bestsellers were also eagerly awaiting a non-existent facelift, such as the 1100-1300 series. The volume car production side of the BLMC, also known as Austin Morris, were making half-hearted attempts at rejuvenating some of their products, such as the newly developed Austin Maxi of 1969, to release alongside the Morris Marina and Austin Allegro. Though the Maxi looked almost identical to its Austin Morris 1800 predecessor, even going as far as using the exactly the same doors, truly lackluster in innovation. Comparatively, the main successes of Britain's car industry during this time, such as Ford and Vauxhall, were doing brilliantly as always. In the space that British Leyland were to be releasing their new Austin Maxi, Ford were also releasing their famed Ford Escort for the first time, now remembered as one of the best competitive rally cars of all time, and a cult classic amongst most audiences.
And Ford's, well, they invested heavily into motorsport because it sold cars to the public.
A consistency featured throughout British Leyland's tumultuous lifespan was the outdated ethics concerning management and worker relations, which were also practically non-existent. More often than not, shop floor workers were to be seen outside on the picket line calling for better pay or better working conditions than inside on the assembly line, and often they rightfully should have.
The problem was the industrial relations, which was totally in the mire in the early to mid 70s, and it affected everything adversely. You couldn't plan anything because you knew it wouldn't actually come to a conclusion. Who was responsible for it? It's like all things, it's six and two threes. We had particularly difficult union sides, but we had particularly inept management as well. They made a hash of it, a complete hash of it. And not, they weren't unique. Ford and Roots had their problems as well, but not as bad as British Leyland. And it ultimately led to its demise.
A large criticism amongst researchers and scholars, including Don Ryder, undertaken his original report for the government in 1975, includes the extent of old, shoddy machinery and equipment that many floor workers had to deal with on a daily basis. Some factories were even partially renovated, with one side span and shiny, while the other was still deteriorating. Unlike British Leyland's competitors, they had not seen any reasoning behind updating or renovating many of their equipment and factories. Turbulent relations also went as far as company loyalty being used as an excuse for arguments between shop floor workers in the early years of the BLMC merger, with many workers being loyal to their organisation on a gang level, reinstating their place and their disregard for workers outside of their circle. Not exactly healthy work relations within a conglomerate that employs close to 200,000 people. This rivalry was often a typical expectation of many large volume production plants such as Cowley and Longbridge, with competition between different groups of loyal workers outperforming each other, though never at the level of manufacturers like Ford or Volkswagen, who were consistently performing well.
Right, well, I was living in Farnborough in Hampshire, and I was the manager of a body shop, a crash repair shop for a Volkswagen main dealer in Aldershot. Being in the motor trade, you knew problems were coming. You just didn't know how.
External events such as the national striking amongst coal miners and electricity workers also had a major impact upon the performance and success of British Leyland during its early years.
It made a lot of inconvenience, especially with power outages. With a body shop, you've got obviously a lot of lights, a lot of power being consumed for compressors and so on, and so therefore meant your weekly planning had to be re-engineered, because you still had customers wanting their vehicles back, etc. Insurance companies would still only pay the same amount of money as before, and you were having to do an awful lot more hard work for it, to be fair.
Again, it made life very unpredictable, and but you learnt to adapt. You had to, really. Mm-hmm.
Much like British Leyland's workers' calls for better pay, many in the coal mining industry were becoming increasingly more unhappy with their wage, as opposed to many other industries keeping up with the times. And an eventual strike in 1972 had a knock-on effect on British Leyland in the form of the National 3-Day Week beginning in 1974.
The 3-day week made life very, very difficult in a lot of industries, and certainly in my own industry, because the nature of bodywork requires lights, heating and so on for paintwork and such like. We would try to get as much crash repair work done in the days with power outages when we could. And then my paint sprayer, he was an absolute gem. Here we would rack the cars up, get them ready for paint, and he would come in overnight and spray as many cars as he could while the power was available during the night time. Because obviously to get a car halfway through an oven and then the power goes off, it ruins it all a bit. But we managed, and like that, and you just adjusted. You adjusted. We still had work, so a lot of people didn't, and a lot of people were suffering from that, so we made the best of what we could.
I had just joined British Leyland, well, not long before, early 73. I joined the profit planning department of the finance team, Austin Morris in Longbridge. I was a chartered accountant by training, but I was working at the time as an analyst in Austin Morris Finance, a materials analyst. I knew nothing about the quality of materials, but I had to study and keep a watch on the global supply of raw materials like steel, aluminium, copper, zinc, and the moving prices of it. And I physically remember writing in my report about the 3-day week, which I got a slap on the wrist from my boss, because he said, there's always been 7 days in a week and there always will be. What you mean is 3-day working, which of course was pretty catastrophic for the motor industry. Because we were producing a hell of a lot of cars in those days. British Leyland, around then, were producing collectively about 1 million cars a year. But if you're only producing on 3 shifts a week, or even 3 double shifts a week, the numbers just tumbled. So it was an expensive time for all the car manufacturers, not least Leyland.
I was in England. I was working in the Home Counties, so sort of area outside of London. I was working for Hertz, the car rental company. The 3-day week affected us in the workplace particularly, because during the winter, we'd be wearing coats and gloves and everything in the office. As soon as it got dark, you'd have to use a torch. And some people used candles, actually. And there was one occasion during that 3-day week when, at the end of the day, I went across the road to the local pub, and after about half an hour we saw flames coming out of the office window, because what had happened was somebody had left a candle burning on their desk, and there were papers stuck to the wall, and a breeze came in, the papers caught fire, and so the whole part of one floor of the building was burnt. It made working life much more difficult, and you had to adapt, but it wasn't a lot of fun.
Bearing that British Leyland were already suffering with terrible work and management relations that influenced consistent striking, the introduction of the 3-day week now put the performance of the non-striking workers in jeopardy too, as even less cars were being produced due to crucial work time being lost.
I remember the 3-day week because there was basically a curfew going on. Because of the, it was, I think it was mostly due to the coal strike or something, because there was no electricity, there was no coal or electricity then. So the government then decided a 3-day week. So in that case, there was no, not allowed to have any lights on in the shops. So I think at night time, all the shops are in darkness, just to try and save energy.
The unclear sense of direction British Leyland demonstrated throughout its lifespan, particularly concerning marketing, also became a catalyst towards its demise. While many British marks were now being produced underneath one united conglomerate, as far as customers were concerned, each brand had its own origin and story. Just as Austin and Morris were once distinguishable brands producing their own vehicles independently, many customers still held this loyalty in mind when shopping for new vehicles into the 70s. Yet, confusion continued to grow amongst British Leyland's customer base, as the plethora of almost identical cars being produced continued to grow in range and volume. This extended into many of British Leyland's dealerships throughout the late 60s and 70s, with many customers unsure of what to actually purchase, as distinctions between badges and models were not obvious to many. And naturally, dealers such as Austin, Morris, and Triumph were competing against each other in sales, while they were all essentially selling the same product, all produced by one company, dividing themselves against each other in the process. Production also shared disappointing standards, particularly in the 70s when striking became a common feature of British Leyland. Cars simply were not being produced at the same quality of many British Leyland's biggest competitors in Britain, whereas manufacturers like Ford and foreign marks such as Toyota and BMW were increasingly becoming known for their general reliability, compared to examples like the Triumph Dolomite Sprint and Triumph Stag. As communication between managers and workers were expectedly low, and many were often outside striking, this lack of direction experience within marketing also worked itself into the assembly lines, with many workers either unmotivated or unwilling to produce their cars to a high standard, or at least comparable with their foreign competitors. Workers were also permitted to more relaxation and non-productive time than competitors such as Ford in Germany, in which workers would often exceed their allocated non-productive time. This, coupled with an extensive overemployment of at least 30,000 workers, led to decreasing profit margins as time went on. A common feature of many British Leyland products were misaligned doors, something that could affect a brand new car with an otherwise acceptable finish in terms of trim and paint. Often, aftermarket bodywork specialists could do a better job of aligning the doors than the many rushed and unmotivated assembly line workers. The extent of efficiency many other manufacturers possessed over British Leyland provides us with an understanding of why many recall the cars of the 60s and 70s to be so unreliable and poorly built. While manufacturers such as Toyota, Volkswagen and BMW extensively used contemporary equipment to assist in production speeds, British Leyland was still relying upon hand tools right up until the 80s, a primitive approach that would appear comedic to many of British Leyland's competitors.
The problems of British Leyland were dramatically underlined when TVI tested how long it took to fit a lock in a Mini. And in a Volkswagen. The German starts at the same time. A demonstration which shows that the Germans have worked out how to do it better, more simply, more efficiently. The German has finished. The Englishman still has over a minute to go before the lock is finally installed. Tomorrow, his union meets management in the latest attempt to get somewhere on productivity. It'll be their 14th meeting in 3 months. Nobody expects any progress.
Although management had been attempting for years to make the switch, the decision to move from piecework rates to measured day rates almost unanimously infuriated assembly workers across British Leyland's factories in 1974. Prior to this, workers were paid on a unit basis, depending on how many doors or suspension components they assembled each day, for instance. But now calls for all workers within each discipline of production to be paid the same day rate, was viewed as an unfair proposal by some 9,000 workers, as one determined worker may assemble twice as many components as his colleague, yet be paid exactly the same rate. Naturally, like many other sour management proposals, this led to calls for striking amongst these 9,000 workers, which further contributed to the vicious cycle of British Leyland's notoriously low production standards.
The build quality in British cars had suffered a lot, and certainly with British Leyland, some of the cars that they produced were pretty awful.
This had a knock-on effect on the number of recalls and warranty work many dealers had to face on a regular basis, since many of the cars that, for instance, Triumph were producing and selling, were so badly produced amongst all of these internal struggles, most cars had to go back to their dealer to be fixed at some point in their life. Astonishingly, almost 23,000 Triumph Dolomite Sprints were produced between 1973 and 1980, and although one of British Leyland's more fondly remembered creations, the Sprint was plagued with engine and structural problems from the onset. With a notoriously bad engine head finish and inferior cooling system, less than 400 examples now exist in Britain. The consistent warranty work seriously affected British Leyland's finances, amongst the other production-related struggles that they are having to deal with, thus heavily affecting any prospects of significant model development or plant improvement. John Barber, a managing director of British Leyland and arguably the right-hand man of Donald Stokes, recognised this lack of attention centred on some of British Leyland's more specialised cars, such as the Triumph and Rover. Recalling in a 1988 interview, "My advice at the time, and all the way through, was that we ought to go a bit upmarket of Ford, and if we had deliberately pitched it beyond the Cortina in quality, image, and so on, we might have done something. But we really ought to have capitalised more on Rover, Jaguar, and Triumph." Desperately attempting to draw in some quick and easy profit during their own financial crisis throughout the early 70s, British Leyland had put all of their resources into producing two new cars, the Morris Marina and Austin Allegro, with the Marina being very simple in design and principle and expected to compete against Ford's largely successful Cortina. The Morris Marina sold well, yet never truly excelled or evolved British Leyland any further than the cars they were releasing a decade earlier. And it is here where Barber makes the point that instead directing concentration on improving their luxury vehicle range may have potentially set them on a successful path throughout the remainder of the 70s. All while British Leyland was slowly collapsing throughout the entirety of the 70s, other manufacturers naturally began to push towards taking their spot of some of Britain's best sellers. These came in the form of many foreign car manufacturers that began to infiltrate the British market in small quantities as early as the 60s. Yet it was amidst some of British Leyland's most turbulent times that manufacturing giants such as Toyota, Datsun and Volkswagen took advantage of British Leyland's struggles.
Well, I never actually owned a Japanese car myself, but when they first came in, they were seen as, by some people, as not much of a threat. And I remember going to a conference once, and one of the speakers was the sales director of British Leyland, and somebody asked him, you know, what about the Japanese? Because Japanese cars had just started coming in, and he said, "Oh, we're not worried about the Japanese." And that was an indication of where they were very blinkered and hadn't appreciated what was actually happening in the marketplace and how big a threat the Japanese cars were. And I think that was, you know, partly attributable to the demise of British Leyland.
Just as many Japanese manufacturers are known for their reliability against many European competitors today, Japanese reliability saw its emergence throughout the 60s and 70s. Datsun, a European market derivative of Nissan, were among some of Britain's biggest foreign car sellers during the mid-70s, with a total percentage of foreign cars on British roads constituting some 30% as of 1974.
And of course Datsun went on to prove they made very good quality products. Initially, of course, many of them copies of ours. But that's Japan's secret. They look at what other people have made and make it better.
Datsun's ingenuity, reliability and quality represented itself successfully upon the British manufacturer market in the mid-70s, with Datsun alone holding some 5% of the entire British market during a review in 1974.
Japanese cars, strangely enough, a lot of people sort of said, oh, they wouldn't do it, and a lot wouldn't have them, but it's because I think it was memories from the war times, and I could understand that. But the build quality of the upmarket Japanese cars was superb, and the quality was in the engineering. They'd thought these cars through, and the 240Z was a great example of that.
Unlike Britain, Japan did not suffer near as much striking and industrial turmoil during their period of growth in the 70s, with the Japanese also adopting some truly radical production principles compared to many Western manufacturers from the 50s onwards.
The Japanese were innovative. They introduced just-in-time and Kanban, and these were just streamlining and improving the quality of production processes. So if you improve the production process, you inevitably improve the product at the end of the construction. And that was their success. They took old processes and updated them with innovation. We underestimated them, seriously underestimated them.
A principle now commonplace in Japanese manufacturing methods first appeared during Japan's rebirth following the Second World War in what they call Kanban, to us, just in time. In essence, this principle followed the idea of consistently ordering just enough parts and materials to produce a car without leaving any surplus or waste, therefore not only eliminating wasted profits on surplus materials that wouldn't be used, but also generally making the entire production plant a clean and efficient place to work, as materials would arrive on the correct time, eliminating the need to store any large surpluses of materials. This naturally involved advanced management and operational skills, since parts and materials departments needed to calculate exactly how many of each particular item they would need on a regular basis, without room for error, further contributing to their efficient and productive work method, in comparison to many of British Leyland's plants either ordering the wrong parts due to lack of communication, or sometimes not ordering parts at all.
Japan at that time was not that far away from recovering from World War, where the whole country was decimated, and it's amazing how innovative and how good you can be when you're starting from such a low base. They'd got virtually nothing. Their industry had been destroyed, so they had to rebuild it, and they were sensible enough to rebuild it in the best and most effective and efficient possible way, rather than just copying what they'd done before.
This just-in-time principle also contributed to general reliability of the cars they produced, as the production path was calculated and laid out extensively, leaving the assembly teams to focus entirely on assembling the cars. Japanese engines such as Datsuns and Toyotas proved to be much more reliable on British soil than many of British Leyland's options, with largely better component production quality in the areas that mattered, such as the engine head, something that British Leyland would often fail at with terrible engine component castings. As many owners would put it, a Datsun would start in the morning, a Triumph may not have.
The engines were brilliant, and electrics were brilliant. You had electric windows and God knows what else for these modern Japanese cars.
Amongst other strengths, the production methods that Japanese manufacturers adopted contributed to Japan's great success within the British market.
This is my pride and joy at the time, the Datsun 140J. I customised it as best as I could for the money I had. Don't know where it is now. I probably sold it for a couple of hundred quid at the time. Sorry I sold it now, apparently worth a few bob.
I had a friend who was a Roots dealer, and he changed from Roots to, I think it was Nissan, and as a result he had to lay off half his workshop staff because the Japanese cars were so much more reliable.
While production quality is concerned, ingenuity was always at the forefront of many Japanese marks, with many Britons inevitably researching more upon their new car purchase during economic turmoil throughout the 70s. Many buyers looked towards what new cars could offer in terms of practicality and ingenuity, not to mention the reliability of the car. Many families needed smaller cars that would perform just as well as many large, guzzling estates that were available from many British manufacturers at the time. And features that we now view as the norm were beginning to show in this time of rapid ingenuity. Manufacturers like Datsun and Volkswagen were beginning to focus on this demand, introducing rear foldable seats, thus turning a compact car into a small estate at the push of a button.
Entry-level British cars, you had to pay extra for a heater and a radio. The Japanese cars, when they came in, that was all standard. So, and they didn't break down.
The economic side of many Japanese cars available throughout dealer networks in Britain also contributed towards a growing shift for foreign manufacturers in the 70s. Naturally, since many foreign manufacturers wanted to penetrate the British market as efficient as possible, competitive pricing was at the forefront of their marketing strategies across Britain. The Datsun Sherry was a direct competitor against some of British Leyland's most prominent compact cars during the 70s, including the likes of the Austin Mini, Allegro, and 1100-1300 series. It was a slightly scaled-down version of some of Datsun's best-sellers, such as the 120Y and 140J, while also featuring a front-wheel drive setup, freeing extra space within the cabin, and a small engine displacement. Buyers could pick up a brand new Datsun Cherry 100A in its simplest two-door form for astonishing £1,140, while a basic two-door Allegro would cost £1,287, Austin 1300 at £1,174, and the iconic Mini at £1,108. With the Japanese badge proving cheaper than almost all of British Leyland's offerings in 1974, it becomes clear to see why a shift in trends began to occur throughout the early 70s. Not only a prospective buyer could purchase a basic, robust Datsun for over £140 less than British Leyland's newly developed Austin Allegro, but also purchase a reliable engine and drivetrain that would not need to be returned for warranty work in regular intervals, much like many of British Leyland's products.
To an extent, I guess we all felt a bit offended. You know, it wasn't a war, but it had those overtones. You know, this is Johnny Foreigner coming in and stealing our, whatever it was, in this case, motor brands. And yes, I think there was probably a fair amount of antagonism.
Adjusting for inflation, £140 back then equates to £1,215 between two cars in today's market. The rise of informed consumer choice throughout the 70s also began to show the advantages of many foreign cars, while displaying the flaws of British manufacturing. The many weekly articles published within some of Britain's most popular automotive magazines, such as Autocar, Motor, and Car, mainly contributed towards this increasingly informed approach towards manufacturer choices.
I think a lot more of them came in the 70s, purely to appeal to the younger drivers. Because a lot of the British cars were more based on family cars, four doors and whatever. Whereas the foreign cars, even now I think, are appealing to the youngsters because they look so sporty.
With continuing scrutiny upon many of British Leyland's products, readers began to understand the many weaknesses they possessed within their production and marketing strategies. Road and reliability tests featuring French, German, and Japanese cars regularly maintained the view that foreign cars were largely more reliable and robust in the long term.
Yeah, they were more reliable. There's no two ways about that. And to be fair, Volkswagen Beetles, they still are reliable. The old ones, the air-cooled ones, not the modern ones. And they'll go on forever more than a day, you know. They're dead, but they won't lie down.
Consumers had the right to know which car performed better, as many would almost certainly come to sell their car one day. And with long-term reliability having a direct influence on long-term depreciation, consumers naturally wanted to focus their interest towards some of the best performers within the category of reliability. Early 1975 saw one of the final steps towards the death of British Leyland, with a nationalisation carried out by the British government to aid an international conglomerate facing certain bankruptcy. This came in the form of a business report requested by the government to assess the finances, management and future prospects of British Leyland by the government's summoned National Enterprise Board, which was led by Sir Don Ryder, the newly appointed chairman of the NEB in early 1975. Donald Stokes addressed his plea for help in a January 1975 issue of Motor Magazine, delving into the details of what was to be assessed and the result of a positive assessment, in which British Leyland would receive a further $50 million in funding. The Ryder report assessed corporate strategy, investments, markets, organisation, employment, productivity, management labour relations, profitability and finance. April of 1975 saw the completion and publication of the Ryder Report to the British public, in which, among other assessments undertaken and recommendations made, the report recommended that Donald Stokes should resign as a chairman, the factories should be renovated and re-equipped, the overlap of model ranges should be fixed and instead adopted into rationalisation, and industrial turmoil be eradicated for good. In simple terms, British Leyland needed to get their backside into gear and accomplish something radical with their proposed additional funding of $50 million.
Immediately the decision for action is endorsed by the membership.
Everyone out was a phrase uttered by Derek Robinson many a time throughout his career as a British Leyland union convener. Robinson, or Red Robbo as thousands of British workers called him, had a long history within the British motor industry, begin as a teenage apprentice in the 1940s. His movement into British Leyland's union as a key member during the 70s was as much a controversy as British Leyland's failing business itself. Throughout Robinson's career, he was a devout believer in communism and the Marxist-Leninist ideologies, in which he heavily reflected within his consistent battles with British Leyland management in favour of the workforce he was representing. This continuously placed a negative attitude upon British Leyland management by Robinson, as many of his strikes advocated for better pay and working conditions, aligning his ethics with that of Marxism-Leninism to break away from capitalism and hierarchy within British Leyland and instead opting for a fairer, more equal environment. It was not until British Leyland faced bankruptcy with the preceding nationalisation by the government that Robinson truly catapulted himself into one of British Leyland's biggest antagonists. 1975 also saw Robinson on a continuous push for radical changes within British Leyland's working conditions, all while Donald Stokes was still chairman. Contrary to Don Ryder's recommendations, the then Prime Minister of Britain, Harold Wilson, who became great friends with Donald Stokes since the 1968 merger, intervened, stating that his sacking, for events that were not entirely of his own doing, would hurt the man terribly. It was highly unfair that he was being made the scapegoat for the sins of his predecessors. Stokes instead adopted a much lighter role within the company, becoming a travelling salesman and promoter of sorts, aligning with his original aspirations all before the troubled British Leyland came about. A new executive director was appointed to replace Stokes, namely Sir Ronald Edwards. Tragically, he only held his position for 4 months until his untimely death in January 1976. It was not until 1977 that a new long-term director was appointed to fix British Leyland's spiralling decline, and this came in the form of South African business executive Michael Edwards. Along with the government nationalisation in 1975, the appointment of Michael Edwards in 1977 further fueled Robinson's negative outlook upon British Leyland. Unlike Stokes, Edwards adopted a much stricter and fuss-free attitude towards the many problems that plagued British Leyland upon his arrival. More than anything, Edwards expressed the need to slim down British Leyland's mass of workers and factories, which followed with the closure of the Speke factory in 1978, which had been producing the Triumph TR7, one of British Leyland's fairly recent introductions to the market. Edwards' no-fuss attitude further infuriated groups of union conveners and shop stewards, who saw Edwards as putting the company's finances before their workers, when in reality Edwards was making sincere attempts at recuperating revenue lost to consistent striking throughout the last few years, such as the production loss of 250,000 cars throughout 1977 due to striking encouraged by union conveners such as Derek Robinson. Unlike Robinson, many of British Leyland's workers were beginning to reason with Edwards and see that he was actually trying to fix the mess that previous management had left, and not solely appointed to put thousands of workers out of jobs. Unfortunately, factory closures naturally meant job cuts, but with over 100,000 workers underneath British Leyland, something radical had to be done, and at the time, one of the only viable routes were to begin cutting the workforce down, thus freeing up overhead costs. Reflecting in a November 1978 issue of Autocar, Edwards stated that "the remarkable reception I got made me happy when I addressed the shop stewards and the national union officials. Also, when I went around the SU carburetors, I got a standing ovation from the workforce, who shouted support for what we were doing." Contrary to typical management announcements in British Leyland, Edwards' February 1978 speech to some 720 union conveners and shop stewards saw a staggering 99% majority in agreement with Edwards' proposals to begin slimming the company down. Yet, with extremely determined individuals such as Robinson, nothing would be enough to begin convincing the union leaders. Throughout years of generally unsuccessful striking, workers were beginning to get tired of striking all the time, especially with no money coming in on the times that they were out on the picket line. It seemed now that the minorities of British Leyland's union were in charge of the majority, and the small numbers of conveners and stewards who consistently called for striking were somehow calling louder than the thousands of workers who just wanted to get on with it. Throughout this, Robinson had not only built up an antagonistic reputation within the eyes of Edwards and the British Leyland management, but was also becoming a public nuisance within the news publishers. And naturally, as anything is exaggerated within the newspapers, the general public were also beginning to see the bad side of Robinson. This continually growing hostility towards Robinson eventually led to his dismissal by Edwards and the British Leyland management in November 1979, following Robinson being caught of putting his name towards a document that criticised British Leyland's proposal to reduce worker numbers. Although Robinson originally had quite a large support network behind him, people began to understand that he became one of the sole causes of British Leyland's atrocious production numbers, inciting hundreds of strikes over the course of the decade. A call for strike action criticising the dismissal of Robinson saw 14,000 supporters drop to 600 within 3 months of his departure at British Leyland's Longbridge plant, thus further supporting the notion that workers were becoming increasingly frustrated with the strike action and simply wanted to get on with their work and earn a wage. The arrival of Margaret Thatcher as Prime Minister in 1979 sets itself as one of the final pieces to the jigsaw that is British Leyland's failure as an international manufacturer. From the onset, Thatcher was displeased with British Leyland's continued disability to detach themselves from the government's support and funding, deeming British Leyland as one of the taxpayers' biggest money pits. Thatcher had intended to send British Leyland on their way to the private sector, freeing themselves of their burden in the process, but owing to Edward's charismatic nature, he not only convinced the Conservative government to withhold their intentions of selling British Leyland off, but also managed to secure an additional $990 million in funding that would largely be used to ensure the upcoming Austin Maestro would make it to the market. The extra funding secured and continued support from the government meant that British Leyland successfully released 4 new models over the next 4 years, with the Austin Metro releasing in 1980 and centering itself as a direct replacement of the outdated Mini, the Triumph Acclaim released in 1981, which was a collaboration with Honda, but in reality a rebadged Honda at its core, and finally the Austin Maestro and Montego in 1983 and 1984.
Some of you may have noticed that for the past few years, Britain has been invaded by the Italians, the Germans, the Japanese, and the French. Now we have the means to fight back. The new Austin Metro. The new Metro is so aerodynamic that at a steady 50 miles per hour, the Metro HLE gets 62 miles per gallon. The new Metro has a split-action rear seat to let you choose between more space or more seats. And to help send the invaders back where they came from, the new Austin Metro goes 12,000 miles or 1 full year between services. The new Austin Metro, a British car to beat the world.
Other than the Austin Metro, which proved itself to be a highly successful and competitive model amongst the press and customers, the Acclaim, Maestro and Montego failed miserably in layman's terms. British Leyland had failed to reach their expected sales of the latter two, and the Acclaim was simply too unimaginative for a car released by an international manufacturer with funding support from the British government. The Acclaim ceased production after a measly 3 years, and although the Maestro was produced until 1995, total production numbers reached just over 600,000, disappointing in comparison to the Metro's 2 million production run lasting until 1998. Edward's tenure as a managing director of British Leyland also came to an end in 1982 after a 5-year contract, and as many important figures are contested throughout history, many applauded Edward's ethics and achievements, and many condemned them. In reality, what Edwards managed to achieve in 5 years in terms of production and management worker relations holds higher than what Stokes, or any other director for that matter, managed to achieve. Edwards managed to leave British Leyland with a glimmer of hope as to what their future may entail, putting his strict attitude to use against the militarist union leaders and inspiring the workers to get back to producing cars. He also made crucial but important cuts where necessary, including factories and workers, all in the spirit of rationalising British Leyland to be one efficient and productive conglomerate. British Leyland would have faced certain bankruptcy in 1979 if it were not for his successful pleas with Thatcher to continue funding them. Therefore, as far as Edwards was concerned, he had left a British Leyland that was in a better state than his arrival in 1977. British Leyland became further rationalised in 1982 with the conglomeration of Austin Morris and Jaguar Rover Triumph into one entity titled as Austin Rover, in a bid to concentrate their focus on some of their best-selling brands, thus effectively killing Triumph and Morris, and separating Jaguar into an independent status. British Leyland themselves also suffered a final corporate shake-up in 1986, being renamed to Rover Group under the authority of Managing Director Graham Day. British Leyland had appeared, suffered, and disappeared within a staggering 18 years, with this final blow burying British Leyland as an iconic British manufacturer, that never quite managed to live up to its expectations. Thus, we reach the end of British Leyland's story as one of Britain's most troubled and criticised car manufacturers, yet amidst their industrial troubles, poor management ethics, and unreliable cars, British Leyland shall always remain as one of Britain's most fondly remembered companies, and despite their atrocious track record, their cars continue to remain as some of Britain's best memories.
You're my